Good evening. Welcome to the celebration of the fourth Saturday after Pentecost. We will follow the bulletin for our liturgy and service this evening. I'd like to remind you to read the bulletin extension, and I'd like to point out a couple of things. We continue to pray for Miss Olowski as she considers the contract we have issued. Pastor Ritter has announced that he received and accepted a divine call to serve Emmanuel and Trinity, and his installation will be on the 9th at 3 o'clock. And so that's again in there. And VBS is in there, and so please take a look and mark your calendars as you see fit. I was told that a Richard Rader passed away yesterday, and his funeral will be at hers at 7 o'clock. So please keep his family in your prayers. Let us open with our opening song.
Forever, our hope, our strength.
In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost. Amen. If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. Let us then confess our sins to God, our Father. Most merciful God, dear beloved, I have good news. Almighty God, in his mercy, has given his Son to die for you, and for his sake forgives you all your sins. As a called and ordained servant of Christ, and by his authority, I therefore forgive you all your sins, in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost. I will sing of the steadfast love of the Lord forever with my mouth, and I will make known your faithfulness to all generations. Who exalt in your name all the day, and in your righteousness are exalted. For our shield belongs to the Lord, our King, to the Holy One of Israel. In peace, let us pray to the Lord. For the peace from above and for our salvation, let us pray to the Lord. For the peace of the whole world, for the well-being of the Church of God, and for the unity of all, let us pray to the Lord. For this holy house, and for all who offer here their worship and praise, let us pray to the Lord. Help, save, comfort, and defend us, gracious Lord. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Dear and gracious Father, bless us on this evening as we hear your word as it is given and received according to your peace and your mercy, and let us live in that very forgiveness. For you liveth and reigneth with thee and the Holy Ghost, one God, now and forever. You may be seated for the reading. Tonight's Old Testament reading comes to us from Jeremiah, the 28th chapter. Then the prophet Jeremiah spoke to Hananiah, the prophet, in the presence of the priest, and all the people who were standing in the house of the Lord. And the prophet Jeremiah said, Amen. May the Lord do so. May the Lord make the words that you have prophesied come true, and bring back to this place from Babylon the vessel of the house of the Lord and all the exiles. Yet hear now this word that I speak in your hearing and in the hearing of all the people. The prophets who preceded you and me from ancient times prophesied war, famine, and pestilence against many countries and great kingdoms. As for the prophet who prophesies peace, the word of that prophet comes to pass. Then it will be known that the Lord has truly sent the prophet. This is the word of the Lord. The epistle is from Romans chapter 7. Do you not know, brothers, for I am speaking to those who know the law, that the law is binding on a person only as long as he lives? Thus a married woman is bound by law to her husband while he lives. But if her husband dies, she is released from the law of marriage. Accordingly, she will be called an adulteress if she lives with another man while her husband is alive. But if her husband dies, she is free from the law. And if she marries another man, she is not an adulteress. Likewise, my brothers, you also have died to the law through the body of Christ, so that you may belong to another, to him who has been raised from the dead, in order that we may bear fruit for God. For while we are living in the flesh, our sinful passions, aroused by the law, were at work in our members to bear fruit for death. But now we are released from the law, having died to what to which held us captive, so that we serve not under the old written code, but in the new life of the Spirit. What then shall we say? That the law is sin? By no means. But if it had not been for the law, I would not have known sin. I would not have known what it is to covet if the law had not said, you shall not covet. But sin, seizing an opportunity through the commandments, produced in me all kinds of covetousness. Apart from the law, sin lies dead. I was once alive apart from the law, but when the commandments came, sin came alive and I died. The very commandment that promised life proved to be death to me. For sin, seizing an opportunity through the commandment, deceived me, and though it killed me, so the law is holy, and the commandment is holy, and righteous, and good. Did that which is good then bring death to me? By no means. It was sin producing death in me through what is good, in order that sin might be shown to be sin, and through the commandment might become sinful beyond measure. This is the word of the Lord. Let us stand in honor of the gospel lesson. The Holy Gospel according to St. Matthew, the 10th chapter. Jesus says unto you, Do not think that I have come to bring peace to the earth. I have not come to bring peace, but a sword. And I have come to set a man against his father, and a daughter against his mother, and a daughter-in-law against her mother-in-law. and a person's enemies will be those of his own household. Whoever loves father or mother more than me is not worthy of me, and whoever loves son or daughter more than me is not worthy of me, and whoever does not take his cross and follow me is not worthy of me. Whoever finds his life will lose it, and whoever loses his life for my sake will find it. Whoever receives you receives me, and whoever receives me receives him who sent me. The one who receives a prophet because he is a prophet will receive a prophet's reward, and the one who receives a righteous person because he is a righteous person will receive a righteous person's reward. And whoever gives one of these little ones even a cup of cold water because he is a disciple, truly I say to you, he will by no means lose his reward. This is the gospel of the Lord. You may be seated. Grace, peace, and mercy be unto you from God, Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Amen. Let us pray. Dear and gracious Father, only through Christ our Lord and the work in which he has done on our behalf do we know peace, the peace of knowing that we have salvation and that the wrath we deserve has been taken away and we have your mercy and live by your grace. To this end, use the words that flow from these lips to proclaim your great mercy in Christ Jesus. Amen. Dear brothers and sisters in Christ, we are in the midst of the July 4th weekend, and it gets to bleed over into the week. We get to celebrate who and what we are. We're Americans. And in the midst of this, we celebrate the joy of what we have in this country. And the biggest thing that we get to claim that we have, and it's not really a claim, it is a fact, is simply freedom. We have these freedoms, and we enjoy the life to do and to work and to live in and on and through what has been given to us. Now, where do I celebrate the signing of the Declaration of Independence and all the things that were connected to that? And we have the promise of living in this country. We have the promise of freedom. But we know that this freedom just didn't happen. It just didn't fall out of the sky. We didn't just one day announce to the world we're free, and then everything was happy, everything worked out. We didn't have to worry about things. Throughout the history of this country, what have we had to do? We've had to defend this freedom. We've had to defend the peace that this freedom creates. We've had wars, let it be the Revolutionary War, let it be World War I, World War II, the Civil War, when we even fought against ourselves to figure out what the freedoms were and how they worked out and how they were lived out and what we could do. In the midst of this, the history of this country, we have fought. And so how is it that we say that we have freedom and we have peace if we are at war? And it gets kind of hard to start thinking that, oh, we live in the greatest nation, we have freedom and peace, let's go fight. It just doesn't seem to work out. But we know, and it's quickly easy to find, that when we do war against other nations, when we do fight, it is for the preservation of what we are and who we are. We fight to protect this peace. We fight to protect and ensure freedom so that we may live. And so it seems so odd to have our Lord, the one who has been promised to come down, the one who has promised to come and deliver peace, mercy, and grace, the one who sent out the 72, who sent out the 12 and says, when you enter a house, say, peace be with you. And then he says in our gospel lesson, I didn't come to bring peace. I come to bring, to set father against son, mother against daughter, mother-in-law against daughter-in-law, and so on and so forth. And so how is it our Lord, who is the one who is supposed to bring peace? Isn't this what we sing during Christmas? Isn't this what the angels sang? That the peace of the Lord would be with Christ. And then Jesus shows up and says otherwise. How does this work? And how are we supposed to deal with this? Are we supposed to now pick fights and say, Jesus told me that he didn't bring peace? And we even have Jesus with a sword coming out of his mouth on the cover of our bulletin. And all of this points to who and what Jesus is. When Jesus comes, he comes to, in fact, bring peace. But when he brings this peace is foreign to the world. Our Lord tells us that I come to bring peace, the peace that the world cannot understand or give. So what happens when this peace shows up? Well, the world, even our sinful nature, rebels against this. No, I do not want this. I want strife. I want malice. I want to pick and poke at other people and cause problems. It's what we do. And what does our Lord do? He comes and says, the peace that I bring is the very peace that's going to create discord. It's going to create hurt. It's going to harm, because you will be something different that the world doesn't understand, that the world cannot deal with. And when the world and when we cannot deal with or understand in the fullness of something unknown, what do? We try to squish it. We try to minimize it. We try to push it away. We try not to deal with it. But our Lord, being the God of God, light of light, very God of very God, he is not squashed. He is not easily put away. For what our Lord has given to you, he has given you true freedom. He has really, truly set himself against and created war against sin, death, and the devil, so that peace would be given to you. The wrath of God that you deserve has been covered by his love, by his mercy, by his grace. This is the peace that we have. And because we get to have this peace, we get to then turn to one another, and we get to celebrate, we get to love, we get to have the freedom to be Christians with one another, building each other up, and not simply just building, but living, and not simply living, but communing, and not just simply communing, but having all the gifts that God delivers in the community of the saints, the communion of the saints. We get to be his people. And because we are his, we are no longer ours. We are no longer the world's. And so what does that mean? It means strife. It means hurt. It means heartache, because we now live for something bigger and grander than little old me, than my family, than this nation, than this world. I live in and through Christ, because he lives in and through me. We were baptized, and because we are baptized, not only is God's name, Father, Son, and Holy Ghost, placed upon you, but so is his righteousness. And we get to go out into the world, and we get to face the world, knowing that he has already done all that needs to be done to rescue us, so that we now live in this great freedom. We live in the freedom to love. We live in the freedom to believe. We live in the freedom of salvation, which is, once again, we don't have to worry about sin, death, or the devil. They have no claim. They have no power. They can do nothing against you, because Christ has already claimed you as his. And because he lives, you too get to live. And so we come back to the situation that we have this peace, we have this life, and this life is contrary to everything that you see and hear, because this is the changing of the inner person. And because it's the changing of the inner person, now your acts are different. Now the very words of your mouth are different. And now your thoughts are different. And they don't work with the rest of the world, because the rest of the world says, serve yourself, pick yourself up by the bootstraps, look out for number one. But yet our Lord, we hear the simplicity of the service that he gives to us. And whoever gives one of these little ones even a cup of water, because he is a disciple, a believer, one of faith, truly I say, by no means will he lose his reward. We have the gifts of heaven and the fullness of God at work to and with us. And because we have all of that, we have freedom to celebrate, freedom to live, freedom to be the people he has made us to be. And that simply means that we get to look at the world, and we don't look down upon, oh, look at them. They don't have the peace and they can't understand it. But we look at the world and we see what is there. We see those who haven't heard, those who do not know, and we get to go out and we get to be the little lights, and having the light of Christ shine forth. And we do this because he has done that for us. He has brought us out of the darkness, of the bondage of sin, the bondage of death, the bondage that our flesh creates. And he has unleashed us into the freedom of his love, the freedom of his peace. This is how we approach everything, knowing that we have his peace. We get to look at others and say, and be the peace that God delivers. And often this may not be a good thing. This may not be a nice and delightful thing. For how often do you sit next to someone, a complete stranger, and you just feel this great urge to tell them everything you know about Jesus? Or do you just sit there politely and say, hi? We live in a hard world. We fear what we will look like. We fear what we'll be thought of. We fear offending and hurting. But yet Christ our Lord came and suffered all our hurt, all our harm, so that we would know him, so that we would know peace, so that we would know salvation and the promise of forever already taken care of, which again means that we get to go out into the world and suffer the discomforts, suffer the awkwardness, suffer the goofiness, and sometimes even the hurt and the offense that faith and love that we have in Christ creates. Go forth and serve. Go forth and live in the freedom of all that has been given to you in Christ, for your reward is great, and it waits for you in and through Christ, in and through heaven forevermore. This is yours in the faith created and sustained by God, Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Amen. Let us stand as we continue with the Nicene Creed. I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in all things visible and invisible. Let us pray for the whole church of God in Christ Jesus and for all people according to their needs. Father, we thank you that you have released us from the law and that we now belong to Christ. Help us always to serve you in the new life of the Spirit and bear fruit for you. Lord, in your mercy. Father, we thank you for all you do to provide us with our daily bread. Be with all who work to grow the fruit of the earth that you have given us food for us for food. Give them favorable weather and a successful harvest. Bless also all involved in the commerce and industry of our land. Allow the fruits of their labors to provide for the material needs of the many who rely upon them. Lord, in your mercy. Father, we thank you for our own nation and for the many freedoms that you have provided for us here. Guide our elected and appointed leaders to serve us with integrity. Be with those who defend our freedoms and the armed forces, as well as the police and firefighters who protect our freedoms closer to home. Lord, in your mercy. Father, we thank you for the freedom from sin, sickness, and death that will come with the full manifestation of your Son's kingdom. Give comfort, healing, patience, and endurance to all who are in need. We pray especially this day for Doris, Dana, Pat, Marie, Dorothy, Bob, Nancy. We also pray for Dolores, Tom, Jeff, Elijah, Beulah, Marilyn, Dennis, Barb, Norma, Hal, Grace, Jean, Kathy, Larry, Dale, Buddy, Randy, Jeanette. We continue to pray for Diana, Dakota, Tom, Jim, Nancy, Chris, Charlene, Norma, Harper, Garrett, Gary, Elaine. We also pray for Kelly, Leona, Eloise, Peggy, Marguerite, Amy, Alicia, Alfreda, Mike, Ron, Mona, and Bill, Natalie, Clara, Craig, Steve, Karen, and Dulcie. We pray for all who suffer from illness, injury, or chronic affliction. Strengthen their faith so that they may know that despite their suffering, they have not lost their reward. Lord, in your mercy. Father, we thank you for the seasons and the means to travel the earth that you have given us. Keep safe all who journey, whether by land, sea, or air. Bring them safely to their destinations and see them home again. Lord, in your mercy. Father, we thank you for the foretaste of the feast to come that comes in the body and blood of your Son. May this eating and drinking strengthen our faith, bind us to you, and free us for service to others. Lord, in your mercy. Father, we thank you for the great cloud of witnesses that surround us. Join our praise with theirs and bring us at last with them into the full freedom of your kingdom. All this we pray through Jesus Christ, who liveth and reigneth with thee and the Holy Ghost, one God, now and forever. You may be seated as we continue with the gathering of the offering.
More than enough.
Kingdom and teach us to pray.
Ways grow, and all of my heart turns to stone, and I'm left with no strength to arise. How you need to be lifted high. Sin and its ways lead to pain. Left here with hurt and Jesus, you be lifted high. You be lifted high. You be lifted high. You be lifted high in my life, oh God. And I fall to my knees, so it's you. Jesus, you be lifted high. And even now that I'm inside your hands, help me not to grow prideful again. Don't let me forsake sacrifice. Jesus, you be lifted high. And if I'm with the riches of kings, how could I ever think that it was me? For you brought me from darkness to light. Jesus, you be lifted high. You be lifted high. You
Let us stand for prayer. We give thanks to you, Almighty God, that you have refreshed us through this salutary gift, and we implore you that of your mercy you would strengthen us through the same in faith toward you and in fervent love toward one another. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who liveth and reigneth with thee in the Holy Ghost, one God, now and forever. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace.
For the heart that holds on.